Benjamin. Today is February 2nd, 2007. I'm here covering the Obama rally for Mason Cable Network. Students have gathered here hours before the speech that is to be given by Mr. Obama. Of course, the young senator from Illinois, very charismatic. Let's hear what some of the students are saying now. I'm here speaking with
Luis Contreras,
Tian Huyen,
Melissa Wong.
And why did you guys come out here today?
Well, we came out to support Barack Obama because he seems like a pretty good presidential candidate.
I mainly wanted to see about what Barack Obama's all about, what his positions are on the issues. I'm interested to hear what he has to say because, I mean, he came here for a reason.
We're very big supporters of Barack Obama, and this is the first speaking engagement that we heard about him having around here.
I came out here because I wanted to see Barack Obama. I want him to know that the American people support him, not just the college kids, but us older folks, too.
Well, when I heard Barack Obama was coming, I was really interested because, you know, I've seen him on TV. You know, his reputation does precede himself, and I wanted to see what he's really about. And he's a great public speaker. I've read a little bit of his book, and I'm really interested in his personality as well as his political standpoint. Now he's holding in when he used to make it
talk so tough. Why should we vote for him instead of Edwards or Clinton?
Well, I think a lot of people are hesitant to vote for him because he doesn't have as much political experience. But I think that's positive because he hasn't had a chance to be corrupted by, you know, the world of politics.
He can use inexperience to his advantage because he could say that, you know, he brings something to the table, as I said before. And he's young, vibrant, outgoing. He believes in listening to everyone and taking all beliefs in. He is a Democrat, but he listens. He doesn't block other people out. So I think if he emphasizes that, that will be a very important feature to this campaign.
But let's not be here
because
we're content with the celebration. Let's leave here today with the hunger and the readiness to make a difference and to support Barack Obama so that we can restore the hope that we all have in our country.
We'll join together not only to celebrate 1 million strokes for Barack, but also a dawn of a new day in America when Barack Obama will announce the beginning of his journey to the White House. Take my hand, make it last forever. Whoa, leave it all to pray. Whoa, we're halfway there. Whoa, leave it all to pray.
I'm here because I love Democrats, and I believe that the next Democratic candidate is going to be the next American president.
He's also a voice for all that is good in this great country. But one more time, can I get the yes we can?
Yes we can! I present to you the hope for America's future.
Good job, boy.
throw a party.
Are you guys all waiting for the basketball game? Together. This is a remarkable achievement, and a remarkable event that speaks to, I think, what's possible when young people put their mind to something. A couple of people in particular I want to acknowledge. First, Meredith Siegel, Executive Director, Students for Barack Obama. Come here, Meredith. This is Meredith Siegel. Tobin Van Arsen, Deputy Director, Student for Barack Obama. And then we've got Farouk Arifbe, who started Barack Obama 1 Million Strong. Where's Farouk? These three young people took it upon themselves to start building an organization before I even had declared that I was interested.
We know it.
For president. And it's a testimony to all three of them. Of course, Farouk, you know, I understand why he did it, because his name is hard to pronounce like mine. So, you know, I'm sort of laying the groundwork for him. I understand that. Tobin and Meredith, folks, you know, I don't know what your excuse is. But I am so grateful. Give them a huge round of applause. Right? So listen. I love you back. You know, when I first got involved in politics, I was not planning to make it a career. I, as some of you know, I actually started public service as a community organizer. And I was working in low-income neighborhoods on the far south side of Chicago. Chicago, we're in the house. And communities that had been devastated by steel plants that had closed. And I was your age. I had been active on campus at the time. One of the major issues was the anti-apartheid movement. And students all across the country mobilized to make sure that presidents and trustees of major universities divested from South Africa and helped put pressure on the apartheid regime. And so I'd been active in that. And I decided I wanted to be a community organizer. I didn't know exactly what it meant, but there were a group of churches that agreed to hire me for $13,000 a year, plus car expenses, to work with them to try to deal with communities that were decaying. Steel plants had closed, people had been laid off their jobs, there had been racial transition in some of these communities, and so I went out there, not knowing anybody, to work with ordinary folks, teachers, school bus drivers, janitors, secretaries, to see what could be done to rebuild these communities. We set up job training programs, and we set up after-school programs for kids. We helped to clean up vacant lots and put playgrounds on them and deal with environmental issues in the community. After I went back to law school and came back, people remembered my community involvement, so they asked me if I'd be interested in running for the state senate. A seat had opened up in the neighborhood where I live. And I did what every wise man does when confronted with such a decision. I prayed on it, and I asked my wife. That's right. And my wife said, well, if this is something you want to do, you can try it out. So then I did what every first-time candidate does. If any of you ever decide you're going to run for office, basically, you go around and you talk to anybody who will listen to you. And so I went to beauty shops and barber shops and PTA meetings, and if there are two guys standing on a corner, I'd pull up and start handing them literature. And everywhere I went, I get the same two questions. First question, where'd you get that funny name Barack Obama? Except people didn't always say it right. And they called me Alabama. Or they'd call me Yo Mama. And I'd have to explain how it's Obama. I thought it was from Kenya, from Africa. We got some Africans
got
in the house.
A lot of Kenyans here.
My mother was from Kansas. Kansas, area. Kansas. That's where I got my accent from. But the other thing people asked me, they said, you know, you seem like a nice young person. And you've got a fancy law degree. You teach at the University of Chicago Law School. You practicing civil rights law, beautiful family, wonderful kids. Why would you want to go into something dirty and nasty like politics? Why would you want to go into politics? And the question's understandable because at some level, even those of us who are active in politics feel a certain cynicism about the political process. You know, we open up the newspapers or we turn on the television set, and it seems as if everywhere you go, politics is a business and not a mission. And the power is always trumping principle. And you've got a lot of self-appointed leaders who are long on rhetoric but short on follow-through. And so people feel disturbed and they feel cynical. And maybe they go and vote every 2 years or 4 years, but they don't really have confidence that government is going to make a difference in their lives. In fact, they hope the government does them no harm. And nobody's more cynical about politics and government than young people, because they've grown up in the midst of a politics that is all about slash and burn, nastiness and negative ads and name-calling and gridlocks. And so you guys don't have much of a memory of the possibilities of a politics that transcends and brings people together. But here's what I told people when I first ran for office, and it's something that I still say today. And that is that there's always been a running thread in American history of a different kind of politics. A politics that's based on a very simple idea that we are all connected as a people. That we all have a stake in each other. That we have mutual responsibilities for each other. That I am my brother's keeper. And I am my sister's keeper. And yes, we value our individual liberty. And we love our individualism and the lack of conformity that's allowed in this culture. But what we also always value is a sense of community. And a belief that if, in the words of Dr. King, if there's an injustice anywhere, then it's a threat to justice everywhere. And that's the spirit of the kind of politics I've tried to practice in the state legislature, the kind of politics that I've tried to practice in the United States Senate, and the kind of politics that I hope to be engaged in a campaign over the next year. But here's the thing. I can't do it alone. No, listen up, because this is important. People have been asking me, what is it that is attracting all these crowds? And my wife asks me this all the time.
Because you have
she keeps on thinking that, you know, what is Prince playing, and you're like the warm-up act, or she can't understand why it is that folks are coming in. And I, what I've tried to tell her, and what I want to tell you today, is this crowd is not about me. It's about you. I've become a receptacle or a vehicle for your hopes and your dreams. But I can only carry it so far. Ultimately, it's going to be you who are going to carry it forward. It's going to be you that makes the decision that you want to see a transformation, not just in this country, but around the world. And Lord knows we need that transformation, because we are at a crossroads in this country domestically, and we're at a crossroads internationally. And I don't have to give you all the facts. You see them on television, you read about them every day. We've got a healthcare system that is broken. And many of you may be on healthcare here at school, maybe on your parents' healthcare, but particularly young people, once they enter the job market, discover that it's not so easy getting healthcare. And if you get sick, it can potentially bankrupt you. And then imagine if you're a mother or a father that doesn't have healthcare, and you see your child get sick, and you've got to take them to the emergency room, and they turn you away because you don't have health insurance. Been there. And a lot of people have. And you wonder, why is it that we can't do something about that? It's not a technical problem. It's not that we don't spend enough money on healthcare. It's that we have not exerted the political will to transform the system so that everybody has basic, decent healthcare. Higher education. You understand that in the midst of globalization, you need a college education and beyond if you're going to be able to compete, not just against folks in California or Texas, but folks in Beijing or Bangalore. And yet, what does Congress do? Instead of making student loans cheaper, they make them more expensive. Instead of cutting out the middleman so that young people can have access to more education, we continue to fatten the profits of banks who serve as middlemen for no purpose because of the politics of Washington. People understand that our education system, for many people, is broken. And there are young people just as talented as you, just as deserving of you, all across the country that never get a shot. That start off in schools that are broken down with inadequate textbooks and rats outnumbering computers. This generation, more than anybody, understands that unless we have a serious energy policy, we may not have a future. That not only does it cripple our economy, not only does it threaten our national security, but it actually threatens the very well-being of our planet. And so you look at that and you say, well, why can't we do something about that? Why can't we make a difference? And the answer is you can. You know, I wrote a book titled The Audacity of Hope. Some folks ask me, where did I get the title? And I told them I actually got the title from my pastor in Chicago named Dr. Jeremiah A. Wright Jr. And I did not grow up in a church. But when I was a community organizer, that's when I joined this church. And I walked in one day and he gave a sermon titled The Audacity of Hope. And the idea that he offered was very simple. He said, you know, the easiest thing to do in life is to be cynical. The easiest thing to do in life is to say nothing's going to change. You can't make a difference. The world is as it is. You look around, you see famine and poverty and despair and cruelty and injustice. There's nothing we can do about it. But here is the idea, he said. What's truly audacious, what requires risk and boldness and courage, is hope. the belief that, in fact, the world as it is not the world as it has to be. That it's possible, just possible, that if each of us get over the fears and constraints and inhibitions to our imagination and decide to work together, that we can completely transform this place. And I love that idea of the audacity of hope, because not only did I love it for myself, because it told me that, you know, to be hopeful is not to be blind to problems, it's to look squarely at problems and decide that we can solve them. To face up to injustice and racism and poverty and war. But it's also because the history of this country, to some degree, has been built on that audacity. I mean, think about it. This country started with a bunch of ragtag colonies deciding to overthrow the most powerful nation on earth and start their own country. And then when they decided to start their own country, they said, you know what, we're not going to do like they do back in Europe. We're not going to have feudalism and monarchy. We're going to have this government of and by and for the people. And then somebody noticed, well, you know what, you've got slavery on your shores, and I guess that's how it's got to be. You can't change that. But some people said, no. We actually think that we can transform this and create a more perfect union. And so a civil war was fought. People marched, and people spoke out, and people went to jail in order to create that more perfect union. And then some people said, well, we noticed that women can't vote. And you know women weren't going to take that, because they understood, you know, we're smarter than these guys are. But they started marching and agitating until they got the right to vote. And at each and every juncture of our history, somebody's been audacious enough to say, we can do something different. And more often than not, it's been young people who've done it.
Yes, sir.
When a Vietnam War was being fought that people realized made no sense and was destroying our credibility in the world, it was young people who stood up and said enough. And when Jim Crow still was the law of the land in half of this nation, it was young people who got on buses and went down south. And the registered voters in the bus. And the same thing is true today. It hasn't changed. We have a war today in which we should have never waged it, and our leaders don't know how to end it. Young people have to get up. We have an economy that is serving the few but not the many. And it's going to be a legacy of debt and decline unless we make some difficult decisions around issues like health care and making sure that our prosperity is spread all throughout the economy. It's not going to change unless young people change it. We've got a problem of climate change that may be more threatening to our civilization than anything in my lifetime or your lifetime, and you are going to have to deal with it. And if we don't deal with it right now, it may not be something that we can deal with. But it's only going to happen if you decide it's going to change. And so, what I'm hoping that all of you take from today is not that you went to a fun rally, although this was fun. It's not that you went to hear a politician speak, but rather that it made you question and ask yourself, what is it that you can do to make this country and this world better? And if you ask yourself that question, you know, if you feel inside yourself this confidence, this trust in your capacity to put your shoulder to the wheel and change history, then I'm absolutely confident that America will change, and it will change for the better. Just in case you are uncertain of your own capacity to change, just remember where I came from. Just remember that I was born in Hawaii, basically raised by a single mother. Just remember that I've probably made more mistakes as a teenager than the vast majority of the people in this crowd. Just remember that when I moved to Chicago, I didn't know a soul. I don't come from a political family. I've got a name that people can't pronounce. In fact, and I'm going to close with this story. When I first announced that I was running for the United States Senate, people thought, he's done a great job as a state legislator. He's, reformed the death penalty in Illinois. He's expanded healthcare for kids. He has created a more sensible juvenile judge. He will be a good U.S. Senator, but let's face it. Nobody in Illinois is going to elect a guy named Barack Obama. And so we ran our campaign, and we had some great candidates in the race. One guy spent $30 million in the campaign. Another guy was a sitting state comptroller. At the end of the primary, we had won by 30 points. People said to themselves, "Wow, how do you do that?" And nobody was more surprised than me. Well, we still had a general election to run, and we hadn't had a lot of money, and we hadn't been able to campaign much down in southern Illinois. And so Dick Durbin, the senior United States Senator, said, you need to go down with me to southern Illinois.
Yeah.
And for those of you who've never been to southern Illinois, southern Illinois is the south. Edwardsville?
Yeah.
Right there. And if you go to southern Illinois, there's some history there. And we went to 39 cities in 5 days.
Wow.
We went to Edwardsville and Collinville and Caseyville and Baum. We went to every hill and borough and ville in southern Illinois. And one of the places we went to was a place called Cairo, Illinois. And Cairo had a history as the site of some of the worst racial violence of any place in the nation back in the late 60s and early 70s, as bad as anything going on in Mississippi or Alabama at the time. There was an active white citizens council, which was equivalent of the Klan, and there were cross burnings, rumored lynchings, and ultimately blacks couldn't work for the businesses in the community. Ultimately, they had to call in the National Guard to try to deal with the situation. And so as we're driving down, Dick Durbin, who's quite a bit older than me, don't tell him I said that, he's a few years older than me, he started telling me, the first time I went to Cairo was during this period. He had gone there as a young lawyer, working for Lieutenant Governor, to see what could be done to improve the racial climate there. And so he started telling me the story about him going down. And he had taken the bus down, and he got picked up at the bus station by a local volunteer, and he was driven to the motel where he was going to be staying as he was conducting this investigation. And as he's about to get out of the car to go into the motel to check in, the driver grabs him and says, "Listen, let me give you a piece of advice, sir." And he said, "What's that?" He said, "Whatever you do, don't use the telephone in your motel room." He says, "Well, why not?" He said, "Well, the switchboard operator is a member of the White Citizens Council and will report on anything that you say." And this obviously made Dick concerned, but he had a job to do. And so he went ahead and he checked it, went up to his room, starts unpacking his bags. And suddenly, he hears a knock on the door. And he opens up the door, and there's a guy standing there. Mean-looking guy. Big guy. Looks down at him and says, "What the heck are you doing here?" And now Dick's really worried. And so am I, because we're pulling into Cairo as he's telling me this story. And, And we go around the old county courthouse, and I've got all kinds of images of what kind of reception I'm going to be getting. And suddenly, we come to a big parking lot. And the crowd's not as big as this, but there are about 400 people standing there. And as we get closer, I notice that about a quarter of them are black, and maybe about three quarters of them are white. And we get closer still, and we notice that they're all wearing these little blue buttons. It says, Obama for U.S. Senate. And we get off the van, and they're all smiling and hugging and handing us barbecue and taking pictures. And I looked at Durbin, and he looked at me, and he knew what I was thinking, and I knew what he was thinking. If you had told Dick Durbin 30 years ago that he, the son of Lithuanian immigrants, born into near poverty in East St. Louis, Illinois, would be returning to Cairo as the senior senator of the state of Illinois, and that he'd have in tow a black guy born in Hawaii with a father from Kenya and a mother from Kansas named Barack Obama, nobody would have believed it. They would have said, you're crazy. And yet it was happening. And it reminds me of something that Dr. King once said 2 weeks after Bloody Sunday, after some of those young people had gone down and risked their lives, after the marches had been turned back at the Edmund Pettus Bridge, he gathered people up and he said, I understand that you are fearful, I understand that you may be near despair, but let me just tell you something. The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice. It bends towards justice. Here's the thing, George Mason, here's the thing, young people, it doesn't bend on its own. It bends because you put your hand on that arc and you bend it in the direction of justice. It bends in that direction because you decide you're going to stand up for a war that should have never been waged. It bends because you decide that we need a healthcare system for all Americans. It bends because you make a decision that every child in America deserves a decent education, even if they're not there. And that retire with dignity and respect. And you make a decision that we don't want to just be feared in the world, but we want to be respected in the world. And we want to make the sacrifices and take the steps to avoid a melting of the polar ice caps and a drowning of the coast all across this world. You make that decision. And if you grab that arc, think about all the power that's represented here. If all of you decide that you are going to get involved, if you all grab that arm, then I have no doubt. I have absolutely no doubt that regardless of what happens in this presidential year, and regardless of what happens in this campaign, America will transform itself. And the future for my children, and my grandchildren, and my grandchildren is going to be bright. Thank you so much, everybody.
Sir, it's very nice to meet you. I hope you win. You're wonderful business.
Waiting on the world to change. We keep on waiting, waiting, waiting on the world to change. It's not that we don't care. We just know that the body fails. So we keep on waiting, waiting, waiting on the world to change.
Hey, this is exactly where Mr. Barack Obama was standing earlier, where he delivered his great and charismatic speech. The fans and the students and just everybody here loved it. This has been Rick Fincham and Mason Cable Network. Thanks for watching.